Imagine a world where no one goes to bed hungry, where every mother gives birth to a healthy child, physically and mentally, and every human is so well nourished that they are able to live a full and active life at any age. It does seem like a distant dream when over 800 million people don't have access to enough quantity of food, and 2 out of every 5 adults don't have access to the right quality of food. We have been fighting to combat malnutrition in every way possible, but it's a problem that persists. Malnutrition doesn't discriminate against geographies, age groups, economic strata, or gender, which makes it even more important to fight at this level than later. Take these 2 children, for example. The differences may not always be visible, but Annika can perform better at school, while Jambulani is struggling. Annika has better cognitive health and immunity, allowing her to excel in school every day, while Jambulani is constantly low on energy and often falls ill. This is because Annika is getting well-balanced meals and is properly nourished, whereas Jambulani isn't getting the right nutrients and food groups. There are so many reasons behind malnutrition: inappropriate dietary choices, low incomes, and difficulty obtaining the right foods. When someone is deprived of the right balance of nutrients, either through too little food or a limited diet, there can be a severe impact on their health. It's more the quality of the food than the quantity. According to UNICEF, out of 149 million children under the age of 5, 49 million are stunted and 40 million are overweight. The amount of attention being paid to adolescents as a nutritionally vulnerable group with unique nutritional needs in the life cycle is growing, but they are still frequently overlooked. Kofi Annan, former UN Secretary General, once said that nutrition is one of the best drivers of development. Without significant progress to end malnutrition, countries will simply not be able to attain the Sustainable Development Goals set out to transform our world by 2030. But how does this change happen? That's where all of us come in.
Is it over, Anu?
We work with a mission of nourishing healthy lives.
Anu, this video is over?
Backed by the vision of Quantum Leap for sustainable growth and striving for excellence and values to fostering corporate culture with enhancement of creativity and integrity. Hexagon Nutrition has been providing reliable services to the customers with continuous innovation and solutions. We have always been front runners in providing solutions to varied segments of nutrition, like clinical nutrition, wellness nutrition, micronutrient premixes, and therapeutic foods. Having presence in over 72 countries, we make in India and market across the world. Hexagon Nutrition has received multiple awards and recognitions, namely Export Excellence Award by Ministry of Commerce and Industry, Government of India, the Best Healthcare Brand 2016 by the Economic Times, Clinical Nutrition Brand of the Year 2016 by CIMS. Quality is our commitment, and to deliver on this commitment, we have set up state-of-the-art manufacturing facilities at 3 different locations. Nashik. This facility is spread over an area of 5.5 hectares with total buildup area of 45,000 square feet. Chennai. This facility has allowed us to cater to the ever-growing demand of the international market. Tuticorin. Ultra-modern facility spread across 20,000 square feet. Hexagon Nutrition follows strict guidelines and policies to ensure superior quality and accuracy at each step of the value chain, starting right from the procurement of raw materials till the production of finished goods. We begin with supplier audits. Stringent quality inspection and audits of suppliers is done before approving the supplier for the raw materials. Global sourcing of raw materials. Best quality raw materials are procured. Testing of these raw materials is done as per norms and certifications. International audits. Quality check audits are conducted at our facilities by UNICEF and UNWFP, as we are authorized suppliers to these NGOs, World Vision, USA, and World Food Program. Manufacturing practices. We conduct frequent checks of our manufacturing machineries and equipments for microbial contamination and air quality through various methods like air sampling, blender swabs, epoxy flooring, etc. Packaging. We use extra protective foil for primary packaging, and nitrogen blanketing technique helps to preserve and protect the goodness of the product throughout its shelf life. And the final check is conducted for sensory evaluation. Every batch manufactured at our facility is passed through sensory evaluation. This is done to check the taste and consistency of the final product. Hexagon Nutrition has also emerged as a leader in providing unmatched food fortification solutions to domestic and international markets, catering to industries like bakery, staples, dairy, FMCG, beverages, edible oil, and everyday cereals and nutrition drink supplements. We take pride in serving the bottom of the pyramid through innovative solutions like ready-to-use therapeutic and supplementary food. These products specially cater to severe to moderately acute malnutrition patients through community-based therapeutic care programs serving to several international markets. Welcome to our NutriCafe, an ultra-modern experience center in our Chennai plant, where you will be served delicious fortified foods like fortified bread, rejuvenating beverages, nurtured edible oil, etc. The NutriCafe allows us to test and develop new concepts and ultimately helps us to provide best-in-class products to the customers. Hexagon Nutrition is committed to integrating environmental, social, and ethical principles into the core business. Through our CSR activities, we seek to touch and transform people's lives by promoting healthcare and nutrition. Clinical Nutrition Excellence Academy, bridging the gap between theory and practice. An initiative of Hexagon Nutrition, the CNEA platform, has engaged speakers of local and global recognition, covering a wide range of topics from critical care, cancer, surgery, etc. The Academy truly strives towards knowledge sharing, concept development, and looks forward to launch certificate courses. Hexagon Nutrition, making a positive difference in the global arena of nutrition. Your nutrition partner.
Please go ahead, ma'am.
Should we start? Okay. Good afternoon, all the dignitaries. On behalf of ESOCHAM, I welcome all our guests here for this important webinar during Nutrition Month. As we all know that severe acute malnutrition is one of the hardest form of malnutrition in the kids. As per the UNICEF, around 2/3 of Asia and 1/3 of African children are malnourished and they have severe acute malnourishment. Against this backdrop, ESOCHAM is organizing this important webinar. And we have with us Mr. Naveen Jain. We welcome you, sir, on behalf of all the dignitaries. We welcome you. And I would now request our co-chair, Shri Arun Mishra ji, to give his opening remarks.
Thank you very much, Nirupama. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, sir. Perfectly.
Very good. Thank you very much. First of all, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I hope you and family are safe and well in this crisis time. I would like to welcome everyone to ESOCHAM's webinar on multi-sectoral partnership to address severe acute malnutrition during the pandemic. It's a very important topic for all of us to really look at and come together and find a way forward for the country. And that will help us to progress and also cope up with the crisis. I would like to take this opportunity to welcome our esteemed speakers for today's webinar, Mr. Naveen Jainji. He's IAS Secretary, Rajasthan Roadways from Government of Rajasthan. He has been leading in the past National Health Mission for Government of Rajasthan as well. So your valuable experience insight would be very helpful for the discussion. Ms. Indra Maluji, IAS Commissioner, ICDS Maharashtra, Mr. Tarun Veej, Country Director, GAIN, Mr. Vikram Kelkar, Group MD for Hexagon Nutrition, Ms. Deepthi Gulati, Head of Program GAINS, and Dr. Praveen Kumar, Director, Professor, Department of Pediatrics from Kalavati Saran Children Hospital. And Dr. Alka Jadhav as well from Professor Pediatrics in charge NRTC, LMTGH, and Dr. Chaudhary, scientist at Center of Health Research and Development, Society for Applied Studies. We all know the ongoing health crisis around COVID-19 has affected all of us and every walks of life, and it continue to affect. Protecting lives of our people suffering from the diseases as well as frontline respondents have been the priority for the nations around the world. Governments have swung into action since the coronavirus attack created an unprecedented situation that we haven't seen before, and we are still learning every day. I think one aspect that has been greatly debated and continue to be debated is nutrition and role of nutrition in this crisis, which is very critical and important, not only for one part of the society, but across from children to adult to elderly population that we have. And you know that malnutrition continues to be one of India's major problem and is a leading risk factor of death in children younger than 5 years, accounting for more than 68% deaths, as per the recent reports that we have seen, Global Nutrition Report. And there are many other statistics. If you look at, I think I saw it yesterday, but recently ICMR issued that what do we eat? And when you see that report, only 5% of urban rural population and around 18% of urban population gets required protein. That's talking, and we need to address. So it's a quite interesting data set that we can go on, but I don't need to establish the relevance and importance of nutrition in this crisis. And more so, if you look at how it is linking further or aggravating further, is that economic decline that we see and rise of internally displaced people due to the ongoing crisis has only made the matter worse, whether with the migrant laborers and the entire discussion that we have. A displaced population is mostly reliant on food aid, which has a risk of being deficient in key nutrients. Furthermore, lack of hygiene and safe water elevates the risk of getting affected the disease like diarrhea, measles, and malaria, which aggravates to SAM conditions. Pregnant women lactating mothers and children below 5 year of age are most vulnerable in this population. Therefore, what is relevant is that coming together cross-functionally and understand that the different linkages or interlinkages of different ecosystems or actors and stakeholders of the system, how do we find a way forward really to address the issue? And I'm so happy to see again with so many experts today that they will deliberate on this issue. I'm sure our discussion would be very fruitful. And definitely as an ASSOCHAM, as a committee, we will take your recommendations forward and submit to the government as well for their consideration. With that, I hope this webinar will provide us with some valuable insight, and it will be fruitful for all of us and for our audience as well. Thank you very much. And once again, stay safe, stay well. Over to you, Nirupma.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much, Arun sir. In fact, it's our privilege to have you as an opening person. And thank you for setting the tone for today's webinar. I would now call upon Shri Naveen Jain, our special guest for this webinar. He has been given the charge of Department of Skill Development and Entrepreneurship Development. So we would like to hear your views on the subject. Over to you, sir.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon, everybody. My participation in the seminar from my current portfolio point of view is very, weird or very strange, because right now I am looking after the public transportation segment, that is the Rajasthan Roadways. And before that, for more than one year, I was working as the Secretary Labor and Skill. But I have worked as MD NHM, and I have worked as Secretary Health from 2014 to 2018. So for a state like Rajasthan, 4.5 year tenure of one IAS officer is quite abnormal, quite strange, but I was fortunate enough to work for this much period. And as a result, I was able to experiment a lot because I got many good partners. I learned a lot actually, because I am a management student, I am a commerce student, but I'm a good learner. So I keep learning many things. And this CMAM thing, the Community Management of Acute Malnutrition, it was very close to my heart. And the journey of CMAM was really very challenging. At that time, it was very risky also, because in 2014, I found more people opposing the idea of RUTF rather than accepting the idea of RUTF. There were many people who would discourage you, basically. They will not ask you to come forward. Rather, they will say, please, sir, dekh lijiye, aap log RUTF pe jana chahte hain ki nahi jana chahte hain. RUTF to phir bhi bahut zyada, RUTF ka naam sunke hi kuch log, jo hai, they were not happy. So we brought out this word EDNS, Energy Dense Supplementary Nutrition. So that became the word. We thought that, sometimes some words are not good. So let's forget about RUTF and let's use EDNS if people are happy with the word. So the basic idea was, when I joined here in June 2014 as Mission Director and Special Secretary Health, at that time, I remembered my tenure in one of the most backward district of India, Bara, where there is a primitive tribe called Sarias. And we started Rajasthan's first malnutrition treatment center, first MTC of Rajasthan, was established by me as a district collector in 2006. So I remembered all those experiences which I had 8 years ago. And I just said one thing. And at that time, UNICEF was headed by Sangeeta Ji, who is now, I think, in Malawi in Africa. So she was heading Rajasthan UNICEF. So she used to come to me, and I said, ma'am, can we bring MTC to the doorsteps of the child? So she said, sir, this is a unique thing. But actually, then we started building the idea, and fortunately, we got GAIN as a partner. We got Hexagon people around. They told that they have something like that. And then they brought many other partners like UNICEF, GAIN, and then ACF also came, because ACF was also working slightly for this particular purpose. So NHM, Rajasthan, ACF, GAIN, and UNICEF, we formed a partnership. And the first ever, I think, a sample of 10,000 children, I think, because CMAM has been taken up at a very, very, you know, very, very small scale, maybe 100, 400, 500 children. But I think in 2015, we decided to take up, we said that let's take up 10,000 children. And we started the project. And we faced many challenges because we were doing it for the first time. We were not having much experiences from India. And we were not having any experiences of the tribal and desert districts because Rajasthan is unique in its desert and in tribal hilly population. So we had some, you know, different kind of challenges also. But we thought of starting it in the most backward 13 district of Rajasthan. So we took all tribal districts. We took districts from NHM point of view because 10 districts, our 10 districts were declared as the most backward by NHM India. So those 10 districts with some tribal districts which were not taken in those 10. So the number was 13. We started off taking it in around, you know, 50 blocks. And we were trying to take it up for 10,000 children. We had to screen more than 2 lakh children of these blocks to arrive at 10,000 sample size. We were not aware that, you know, from what data 10,000 will actually come up as -3 SD and how to take the first challenge is identification challenge, how you will identify. So we use MUAC, naturally MUAC was used and all the established standards were followed. Then some people said MUAC is only not good because there are other tests also. So I made a, you know, we used a mix of the tests and finally we were able to identify some 9,600 children. I remember that much only now. So in December 15, we launched first ever CMAM project of Rajasthan, and Government of India said that they will not support it because CMAM is not a NHM policy. I think so far it is not a policy anywhere. Everybody is just heading a committee and they are going to come up with solution which we are waiting. I think I wait my for my next stint as Principal Secretary Health. I think by that time this guideline will come and I will be able to contribute more. But this time, due to our partners, we were able to do that. I could give only one thing to them, that I will give the leadership. I will take all the challenges on me. Plus, I will give the entire workforce, AAA, that is ASHA, ANM, Anganwadi, I will give to you. So AAA I will provide, you provide me with technological, technical things. You provide me with food, and food was given by GAIN, and they also made the modules. Modules were also made by ACF. So work was divided. We were experimenting and finding. There was no guide available. In 6 months, we did it, and I think it was most successful because 70% plus children were out of the zone because you again check them for their MUAC and other tests. And then finally, you know, you make out the things that, you know, the ratio has, the results are very good. And particularly in tribal belt, it was a great hit. And we conducted studies after studies, like after 3 months, after 6 months, as you say, without any third party assessment, you don't agree to any achievement. So we sent our teams because we could not get any third party assessment, but still people from UNICEF, people from UNEP-PA who are working with me in other projects, I requested them, can you please go there? And we kept on checking ourselves so that we don't release data saying that we are successful only. We may have been failed, but we may not be knowing. So we sent our teams there and thankfully the children did very well. So looking at that success, the idea was let's take up CMAM as a pilot. And if 10,000 children give good result in 13 most backward district, definitely I can take up it very easily in Jaipur, Ajmer and Jodhpur because they are not that backward. So that was the idea to give some guide, to give some guideline to the future experiment karne wale jo log hai, unko ek guide hum log de sake. Hum logon ne achhi guidelines develop ki, achhe modules develop ki. And thankfully, all the team worked very hard. The best part was weekly monitoring of the health. So we were very clear that weekly we will monitor the health of this child and of all the children who were enrolled for the program. We made a journey book, you know, the first day photo of the enrolled child and the last day photo of the child, how much, you know, apparently how much change was visible on the body, on the face, and plus all the tests. So that was a fantastic journey, and I think we challenged ourselves because otherwise sometime in government programs what happened, we enroll some other person, we give food to some other person, and for success, we may measure some other person. So sometimes it may happen. So we insisted that same children who were identified, who were enrolled, should be maintained in the program. We should not, you know, just disturb our original program to, you know, prove something which is not there. So that was the point. So finally, we also launched second phase in 2018. But 2018, Rajasthan was having elections. We launched in September 2018. And thankfully, we launched it before Code of Conduct came into picture. So when we launched it in September, I started it. We started it on a grand, on a larger scale. This time, we took up around 15,000. We took it up in 20 districts now. Those 13 districts plus 7 more districts we tried. So 20 districts. Now we had Tata also as one of the partners, because this time food was provided by Tata. So partners, the original partners were there. We included one or two more partners. By that time, many states had visited us. I attended many conferences, seminars, and many people always ask, ghar ka bana khana acha hota hai, why RUTF? Do you want to support RUTF industry? I said, I am a management student. I have nothing to do with a factory which makes RUTF. If you make RUTF by SHG or you make RUTF in your home, I am just behind the idea of managing things. I am behind the logistics. I just want to remove the coordination problems. Food, you give me any food. You just give me any food. You give me any food which you think fit. It is the cheapest or best, or from whomever you want to procure, please procure. Just give me that food. I just want to say I will involve my NHM machinery in such a way that, you know, in these days, when any partner wants to implement a program, the biggest challenge is the expenditure on the salaries of the people involved. My DPM was working as district manager. My block manager was working as block manager. My Asha and Anganwadi were working for a incentive that, you know, for one child, you will get this much. For second child, you will get this much. And the best part was incentive was performance based. There was some fixed incentive, but the major part of incentive was based on how many times food was given to the child and what was the improvement in the health. So we gave very objective criteria, and as a result, it was a success, because I think officers, when work with the NGO gene, I think success comes. If officers become officers and NGOs become NGOs and there is no coordination between them, they don't hold meetings between themselves, you know, they never know what the other person is doing. So we were saying same thing. We were representing same thing. We were representing same thoughts. So as a result, we were clear what we wanted. So as a result, I think it was the most successful experiment for me in my life. I will always cherish it. And the second was finished in 2019, but December 18, I was changed because there was a change of government. I was already working for 4.5 years. So my transfer was imminent. So I left on 20th December 2018. And after that second phase results, I really don't know much. Some people came to me and they told me that it was also a good success. There were some logistic issues this time. Unfortunately, when you do something for first time, there are more challenges. But when you do it second time, many challenges are removed because of your experience. But I think but in this case, it was slightly different, because I think the kind of change in the people after December 2018 actually created some issues. But because teams were there, teams were retained there, Gain was there, Tata was there. So I hope that it may have also resulted in very good results, and that can also be shared with people. But one thing I will say for sure, in these days of COVID-19, let me tell you one thing. Now I think, because I worked in war room, because of my 4-year experience, I was posted in war room of Rajasthan. So I tackled it in March, April, May. I tried to help government, because I'm not a health expert, but coordination between health personnels is my ability. So that's why I was used there. And now I'm running public transport. So I have moved 5 lakh laborers from Rajasthan to other state and from other state to my state. So I also know how to avoid infection, to carry people safely. Even now I'm running my buses on daily basis. So I carry 4 lakh people per day. So that's why how to save my people or how to save my passengers from COVID-19 infection. Based on those experiences, I can say 4 or 5 things. MTCs and any hospital ward is normally avoided by people this time, fearing that any health facility may give them infection. They fear that. That facility may not be dealing with COVID people, but they fear that we don't know kon aaya tha, you know, the toilet may have been infected, the bed may have been infected, or the supplies may be carried by a person who may be proved COVID positive after some time. So they fear coming to a facility. So MTCs should be there, But we used to say the children who are between 2 and 3 minus 2 and minus 3 SD, why to take them to MTCs when they can be cured at their homes? So there should be a layer in which a person who cannot be cured by Anganwadi food, a person who is cured only at MTC, there should be a layer between them. There may be a child who is not good with only Anganwadi food and who may not be needing the services of MTC, but still he needs an intervention. I think this community-based intervention becomes very handy, because I have found that many parents do not come to MTCs because of the single factor. They have to be with them. Now, a male member of the family will not like to stay with his child for 7 days because bachche ko maa ki zarurat hai. But he doesn't want to leave his wife at MTC because he fears that she cannot do anything. She cannot talk to doctors. She cannot find the progress. And both of them cannot stay because unke dusre bachche bhi hain jo ghar mein reh gaye. So that's why I find that if you treat children in community, it helps many things. It helps people to actually take up the treatment part. So using ASHAs, ANMs, Anganwadi worker in a perfect manner, give them food when their parameters improve, then connect them to Anganwadis and then monitor them separately, not with the entire 100 children. Monitor those 5 children separately. If that strategy can be introduced in our country as a policy, and I think the biggest obstacle I have found, I can say it unofficially because I'm an official, so can't say officially, but unofficially I will say one truth, and that is the lack of coordination between NHM and ICDS somewhere actually is the main factor why we could not achieve CMM in a institutional manner in this country. And if it could come in institutional manner, I think it could wonders. Only the controversy around feed need to be improved, and any food is welcome. Any company can make it. We welcome any company. We welcome any SHG, any federation to make it. But the philosophy behind this entire concept is very nice. So if we could have introduced CMM and then COVID would have come, I think we could have gained a lot of things. Number one, if you teach mothers to take MUAC measurements, they can do it at their homes. They don't have to come weekly to A&M just to check whether there is an improvement or not. And you remember, Dipti madam, I always insisted that, you know, in second phase, we should take up a module of teaching mothers to take MUAC. Let them be happy when they do it. Let them have that, you know, joy of seeing their children getting better. So I was insisting every time on this. And if we could do it now, so they don't have to come to facilities just to, you know, get this measurement, which can be taken even by them. Secondly, if supply chain of food is disturbed because of transportation problem, lockdown, restrictions, we could suggest them home recipes of many things. And I think that was a part of the game, and we made some videos on that. So whenever there is a supply chain break, we could have insisted on alternate or supplementary food from their homes itself. Because many people also want to have home food. So that gap fill, karne ke liye, then that strategy also can be used. Third is, if there is an emergency, if a child is not reacting well, or he gets ill, he gets sick, then there should be dedicated wards available. And for taking them to those dedicated wards, there should be dedicated ambulance and vehicles, because if we use these 108 or other vehicles which are used even for carrying the suspected of COVID, then there may be an issue. So if you could have one or two dedicated ambulances to take them to the dedicated wards of the, you know, neonatal care or whatever child care system district is having or the CHC is having, if we could manage that. And lastly, if we can we can change the motivational level of our ASHAs and ANM, because that was the most challenging part. That, you know, if even in COVID days, if any child faces a problem, a parent faces a problem, they are there to help them in their own sphere, getting, you know, themselves safe from any infection. So I think CMAM could have been a boon to continue with our nutrition programs if we could have started it before onset of COVID-19. This is my view. And I'm not an expert on this subject. I only think administratively. I think from practical, doable point of view. So that's my limited,
Thank you. Thank you very much, sir. It was really nice hearing you, and it's such an exemplary case study. And I wish you become principal secretary soon and take over things again in Rajasthan. And such case studies are simulated in other states as well. I would now request Mr. Vikram Kelkar, the Group MD, Hexagon Nutrition, to have his views on the topic. Over to you, sir.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Nirupama. Am I audible in the first place? Yeah, is my presentation visible?
It is.
Okay, thank
Please
you.
Please go ahead, sir.
Yeah, so firstly, thank you, Arun, for the introductory session. And thanks to Navinji. It's an honor to have you on this webinar. And you have shared your inspirational journey, citing the real facts. You have indeed been a pioneer from the government, to have actually implemented, a program like this. So my heartfelt compliments to you. Today I would like to speak on the severe acute malnutrition from the industry perspective. So let's have a look at what is malnutrition. Malnutrition refers to the deficiencies or excesses in nutrient intake, imbalance or of essential nutrients, or impaired nutrient utilization. Malnutrition can be categorized into two types. One is undernutrition and overnutrition. In overnutrition, we have overweight and obesity as the problems, and as well as in case of undernutrition, we have acute malnutrition and chronic malnutrition. Acute malnutrition results from sudden reductions in food intake or diet quality, and is often combined with pathological causes like wasting, kwashiorkor, and marasmus. Whereas chronic malnutrition results from insufficient intake or absorption of essential nutrients over a protracted period, like substanting and micronutrient deficiency. Coming to the types of acute malnutrition, we have three. First is the moderate acute malnutrition, which is MAM. Then the severe acute malnutrition, that is SAM. And then the global acute malnutrition, that is GAM. So GAM refers to MAM and SAM together, and it is used as a measurement of nutritional status at a population level and as an indicator of the severity of an emergency situation. Let's have a look at the impact of undernutrition from a global perspective. So malnutrition rates remain alarming. Stunting is declining too slowly, while wasting still impacts the lives of far too many young children. As per the UNICEF, WHO, World Bank Group Joint Child Malnutrition Estimates 2020, during 2019, wasting continued to threaten the lives of an estimated 47 million children under 5 globally, of which 14.3 million were severely wasted. Stunting affected an estimated 21.3% or 144 million children under 5 globally in 2019. Africa and Asia bear the greatest share of all forms of malnutrition. In 2019, more than half of all the stunted children under 5 lived in Asia, and 2 out of 5 lived in Africa. More than 2/3 of all wasted children under 5 lived in Asia, and more than 1/4 lived in Africa. So as we can see, stunting has affected more than 144 million children, and wasting has affected 47 million, and the children who are severely wasted are 14.3 million. These are really big numbers. Coming to the impact of undernutrition from the Indian perspective, so globally, around 15 million children under 5 years of age have severe acute malnutrition, and 40% of these, which is 8 million, are in India. The NFHS data found that children aged less than 5 years, following other statistics, 38.4% stunted, 35.8% underweight, 21% wasted, and 7.5% severely wasted. In the last decade, severe acute malnutrition has increased from 6.4% to 7.5% in India. These numbers are much higher than in other developing countries. Now let's come to the management of the severe acute malnutrition. So children with medical complications are referred to the Nutrition Rehabilitation Centers, that is the NRCs. The Government of India has set up 1,153 NRCs in inpatient health facilities across the country. Children without medical complications can be treated at the community level. The fact remains, as per WHO in India, only an estimated 10 to 15% of the children with SAM are medically complicated and require inpatient treatment. Evidence shows that the remainder 85 to 90% of the children with SAM can be treated at the community level. Community-based management of acute malnutrition, CMAM, is an integrated approach which on one hand focuses on the treatment and on the other prevention. What are the challenges of CMAM in India? Currently, there is a lack of policy and common national guidance to address both the treatment and the prevention of SAM children. In the absence of clear guidelines, community management faces challenges such as poor follow-up of cases, poor networking among health and ICDS officials. This experience was also shared by Mr. Naveen Jain. Lack of availability of proper equipment, no proper data recording, and lack of motivation to the Anganwadi workers. Now let's look at the way forward. Policies and common national guidelines for treatment and prevention of SAM children. The scale-up of CMAM in conjunction with interventions that covers all forms of undernutrition. Multi-sectoral partnership to address SAM. Industry support by providing F75, F100 micronutrient enriched food and energy dense nutrition food, mandate of staple food fortification. According to experts, awareness, scaling of complementary feeding for young children will also show reduction in these numbers. So with that, I come to the end of my presentation.
Yeah, thank you very much, sir. In fact, it is really enlightening to know what are the basics, I mean, status of the severe acute malnutrition in India and what are the present challenges in the Indian system. So it was really nice to hear you, and I'm sure that the contributions from the organizations like you will make a difference for sure. And we are fortunate to have Ms. Indra, Srimati Indra ji, with us. We welcome you, ma'am, on behalf of ESOCHAM, and would like to hear your views on the subject. Indra ma'am, can you hear us?
Indra ma'am, there's a problem with her audio. I'm just checking in and letting her know how to switch
on
the audio.
Okay, fine. Till the time it is sorted, let's take it forward to the technical session. Yes. So I would now urge all the speakers in the technical session that we have time limitation of around 7 to 10 minutes. We have to conclude in 10 minutes. I would now request the first speaker, Dr. Ranadeep Chaudhary ji. He is a scientist at Center for Health Research and Development, Society for Applied Sciences. Dr. Ranadeep, over to you. You need to unmute yourself, sir.
Yeah, can you hear me? Can you hear me now?
Yeah,
just
can.
Let me couple of seconds to share my slides. Can you all see my slides?
We can.
Okay, thank you. Okay, thanks a lot. And thanks a lot for giving me, inviting me for this important, relevant, and critical issue to discuss, and specifically during this pandemic situation. But the topic is as such that it is not only relevant for this pandemic situation, it is relevant for all time throughout the year about the approaches to identify and management of severe acute malnutrition at community level. So myself, Ranadeep Chaudhary, I work with Dr. Nita Bhandari in Society for Applied Studies, New Delhi. And earlier I used to work with late Professor Dr. Bhan. So what is the impact of COVID-19 on wasting? Recently in Lancet Global Health, some modeling studies have shown that the impact, or if I say the indirect impact of COVID-19 on childhood wasting. As we know that COVID-19 currently is not impacting too much on child health, and children are been not too much affected, but it has an indirect impact on wasting. And what is that? So recently it has been shown that 14.3% increase of prevalence of wasting, either moderate or severe wasting, can be possible due to COVID-19. And that may translate to around 6.7 million children with wasting in 2020 compared to projections for 2020 without COVID-19. And most importantly, out of these 6.7 million children, 57.6% of these children could be from South Asia. So this is the burden that can happen as the impact of COVID-19. In addition to that, Robarton et al. In Lancet Global Health showed that commodity reduction, and commodity reduction, they mean to say commodity reduction of different preventive and curative public health programs with 9.8 to 18.5. And this, we need to remember, they have given different scenario, and this is the best scenario they gave, that coverage reduction of 9.8 to 18.5% and increased wasting of 10% over 6 months will result in 253,500 additional child death. So the take home message from this slide is that the indirect impact of COVID-19 on childhood wasting, that we should consider, and we should consider it very rigorously. Now let's come to the issue of identification of SAM at community level during this pandemic time. UNICEF recently came up with some guidelines, though they have specifically mentioned those guidelines from African countries, but that can be applicable from India also. And the issue they are trying to promote here, that promote and enhance the screening of severe acute malnutrition and community level. And the example they are giving, that mother-led or family-led mid-upper-arm circumference method, and intensify the training of community health workers and families, mothers and caregivers, or early case detection of using MUAC. So they are promoting to use MUAC as an identification tool of SAM at the community level. Now, next about the admission criteria of SAM during this pandemic situation, they are promoting a simplified admission criteria like MUAC or MUAC and edema. So if it is MUAC less than 120 millimeter or less than 125 millimeter or edema. So these are the simplified criteria they are talking about. Now the management, the most important thing that Dr. Naveen Jain also mentioned about during his lecture, about the issue of management of SAM at the community level. You can see there are lots of debates are going on outside India, India, worldwide, about use of ready-to-use therapeutic foods for management of uncomplicated SAM at community level. And you can see what I have used the word term, simplified dose of energy-dense nutrition supplements. So the issue is not the word. The issue is the therapeutic food that you are giving to someone who needed it. And in this document, they talked about, UNICEF talked about simplified dose of energy-dense nutrition supplement. And they gave one example of, say, 2 sachets per day of SAM without complication. But here in this slide, I want to discuss a couple of more important issues. All severe acute malnutrition children should be assessed for their complications. And if they have some complication, they need to be referred to the existing health facilities where services are available. This is the most critical issue with or without pandemic situation, because complicated cases should be managed accessibly. The second most important issue about infants who are less than 6 months of age. So infant, because if we see in India also that currently the CMAM programs are going on, mostly these are for 6 to 59 months of infant, the children. And we sometimes forget about the first 6 months of life. So infant less than 6 months of age should also be screened and managed as per growth failure as per the management guideline of WHO 2013. One issue regarding infant less than 6 months would be how that they will be assessed or identified at the community. in this pandemic situation, because if length can be taken, so weight for age could be an potential alternative for this for identification of SAM for infant less than 6 months of age. And the last issue about the all sick children should be screened for wasting and treated as per the national guideline. So my last slide, I will not go much beyond this. So to conclude or to summarize the issue, number one, it's a very important issue, Sam. During this pandemic condition or pandemic situation, MEWAC could be used as a screening tool. MEWAC and or edema could be used as a diagnostic criteria for admission for the complicated SAM. All severely acute malnourished children should be assessed for complication, and the uncomplicated SAM children should be managed at community-based approach. Thank you. I think I have completed within my time.
Yeah, very well. And Dr. Anadeep, I compliment you for sharing the brief of the technicalities of implementation of SAM within the specified time. Thank you very much. And I hope these can be simulated and followed by other technicians also. And I think there is a need of training of the trainer programs also, as I understand. The subject is like that. We need to train the trainers as well. Thank you.
Agree.
Now request Ms. Indra to give her views on the subject. Over to you, ma'am.
Ma'am, you need to unmute yourself. Thank you so much, Ms. Nirupama. I'm sorry I couldn't join early. So I'd like to say my bit in a few words. Number one is that the ICDS, that is the Integrated Child Development Services, that was started in 1975, and now it is spread all over the country. And just 2 years ago, the Honorable Prime Minister has launched Poshan Abhiyan through the ICDS with a particular view to address undernutrition as well as management of SAM and reduction of anemia and stunting, which is chronic malnutrition. Now, since I joined late, I'm sorry I couldn't really, maybe I could be repeating some of the points. But I just want to say one thing, that if you see the overall, the whole material on malnutrition and chronic malnutrition, especially severe malnutrition, you'll find that the primary severe malnutrition flows from those who are wasting, which is low weight for height. And this is added to on by the stunting figures, which is low weight and low height for the weight for the age, sorry. And so, and stunting, which is chronic malnutrition, wasting, which is more like current intake energy deficit, leading to severe malnutrition. So this is a condition which develops over a period of time. And even so, your Lancet studies and other references show that 85% of the severe acute malnourishment cases can be treated through nutrition and other counseling and behavioral changes, whereas only around 15% are really complicated medical cases which need further interventions in terms of, say, heart diseases or some other genetic issues like sickle cell anemia, which is prevalent in parts of Maharashtra here. So our aim really as a program under Poshan Abhiyan through the ICDS is to target these 85% through behavior change, through promotion of sanitation hygiene practices, through again behavior change of right eating. And if I go by my field experience, then what is seen is that especially in urban projects, we operate in the notified slum areas, in the urban areas, and we have 104 projects in all of Maharashtra. And here we see that most of the cases can be corrected through proper eating. And the second is family planning. And I think it is worthwhile to reflect on use of family planning, not just as a traditional tool for population control, but also in terms of spacing between children to allow for the proper nutritional development of the mother as well as the child, and proper care and attention. So secondly, on the other hand, if you see the rural areas, then social problems of early marriage, teen pregnancies also result in higher incidences of low birth weight, as well as the fact that many of them also do not go in for institutional delivery, which again impacts the malnutrition incidence. Now, but going ahead of that, we are all well aware that around 25% of the SAM children are also because of disease factors, diseases which rise out of common, your housing condition, your sanitary condition, your water supply condition. Children you see running around on naked feet during monsoons, sleeping on cold surfaces. So these kind of small things, because SAM child doesn't emerge in one night. It's not an overnight condition, but it is the result of a long-term kind of neglect or long-term kind of helplessness, which results in this situation. I'm happy to share with you all that during the COVID situation, Maharashtra has been striving to ensure the supplementary nutrition program of the ICDS. And we supply dry rations in terms of the wheat and rice, dal, chawli, and then some other pulses, and fortified salt and fortified oil. So we have been supplying this to all our beneficiaries. And in fact, we have seen a rise, increase in the number of beneficiaries by over around 7 lakhs because of in-migrations, because of children, because of schools being closed, then those children opting to then again come in for the ICDS services. So without bias, this administrative flexibility, we have attempted to serve all the population that have sought our help. And along with this, I'd like to share that Government of Maharashtra has a state-led scheme called the Village Child Development Center, in which an energy-dense fortified nutrition supplement is given. So this is basically fortified with micronutrients and is a peanut-based, very rich paste. So those children who do not have medical complications, but who can be treated at home, so they are treated at the Anganwadi level, where they are given this EDNF, and they're also medically screened through a medical doctor. Mostly it is from the RBSK team of the health department. And then, if at all some cases come up that require referral, then they are referred to the Nutrition Rehabilitation Center. But sometimes parents, despite being counseled to take the child, have resistance over leaving their household duties and then taking and going and sitting there just for 15 days, just for one child. So these are some of the challenges. Unfortunately, I have to rush back again to something. So please excuse me, but thank you so much for allowing me to share my thoughts with you.
Thank you. Thank you indeed, ma'am. It was really a pleasure to have you on board and to understand what are your views on the subject, and we'll definitely take it forward and forward you the minutes of the meeting after this.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am, once again.
Ma'am, off mute, okay, ma'am. Mute over, ma'am.
So I would now request the next speaker, Dr. Praveen Kumar. He's the director and professor from Department of Pediatrics, Kalavati Saran Children's Hospital. His presentation would be focusing on approaches of management of SAM during pandemic at in-facility level. Over to you, sir.
So thank you, Nirupa. I just wanted to check whether my screen is visible or still it's not.
Your screen is visible and you're audible too.
So I will be just quickly touching upon this. The problem is my, just 1 minute. Okay, so I will be just talking about this management of SAM children in nutritional rehabilitation center during this COVID-19 pandemic. And as our initial speaker, Honorable Naveen Jain, he has highlighted that during this COVID time, many a times caregiver, mothers, they are hesitant and they usually will not like to come particularly to NRC because they have this that I may get COVID. So it's true, and why this topic is important, and probably NRCs also, they have to take certain measures to manage and prevent this COVID-19 in respective MNCs. So first, who all may transmit infection? We know this COVID-19 transmission may occur from caregiver of admitted children. NRCS staff, they themselves may be having COVID infection. Other hospital staffs visiting NRC, they can carry. And admitted children also, although most of the time they are asymptomatic, but they are able to transmit. So every person is potentially a carrier if we do not abide by the preventive measures. So that is what we have to remember. So measures to prevent COVID-19 is not very different. NRC staffs, they need masks. They also need gloves, gown, head cover. That is what is required for NRC staffs. Each NRC, this would have necessary arrangement for hand washing because they should ensure that every attendant or every caregiver or any new admission, if they come to NRC, so there should be provision for hand washing. Cleaning and sanitizing of the instrument and utensil as per guideline. Particularly the anthropometric instruments, which includes the stereometer, infantometer, weighing scale, MUAC tape if you are using, then in between two patients, we have to sanitize them, which also was recommended earlier, but this has become even more important during COVID time. Then drug trays, utensils, no other also, we have to sanitize them as per recommendation with 70% ethyl alcohol at regular interval. NRC floors should be cleaned regularly with disinfectant like sodium hypochlorite. And then other cleaning measures, which is there in NRC also. So what are the changes at this point of time during COVID? Now there are certain changes, and we have stopped group counseling, group play therapy of the children. The group cooking demonstration is also not happening. Entry of more than caregiver, we don't allow in MTCs. And also we are not having, and we are taking measures so that same as for playing by more than one children is not allowed. So what is the change? We have started individual counseling in place of this. We encourage mother for individual playing, and then the counseling is there for improving the dietary and how to they can prepare energy drinks, food item after this change. Then before NRC admission, each child and mother caregiver should be screened for influenza-like symptoms, that is fever, cough, breathlessness. Whenever these symptoms are there, all the NRC, they have been advised to refer to COVID screening area. Until the time report is available, the child is managed in the isolation ward, which is meant for COVID, suspected COVID area. Although all the therapeutic feeds are being provided in that area also, so that the treatment is not problem. And if the child or mother is found to be COVID-19 positive, then they are isolated as per standard recommendation. Then during admission, if the children with SAM and medical complication without influenza-like symptoms they have, they are being admitted in NRC. And if they have influenza-like symptoms, they are managed in separate area. Children with influenza-like symptom, and if they found to be COVID-19 negative, then they also are subsequently transferred. The clinical management is not different. It remains unchanged. So however, whatever I have already highlighted, there are certain changes in group counseling, group play therapy, which we have. And then NRC staff, they also are keeping a watch for appearance of influenza-like symptom in any of the patient who is admitted there or any of the caregiver. If there is any such patient, then they are isolated and sent for COVID screening. Regarding this discharge from NRC, now there is slightly we are not keeping them for fixed duration. And if the children are stable, they have inter-rehabilitation phase, and their medical complication have been treated, then they are usually discharged. And if they are discharged early, usually we advise them to continue multivitamin zinc folic acid or no after discharge. So that is regarding during this. And then for follow-up, there is telephonic follow-up for all discharged children. We are not calling them unless they have some medical complaint. So physical follow-up is only done when they have some medical complication. They have been advised to follow up at Anganwadi center for documenting weight gain and gender health checkup. If the list of SAM children also needs to be shared to Anganwadi center for prioritizing their post-discharge follow-up and delivery of take-home ration, which is there. And during follow-up, all health staff, ASA, Anganwadi worker, parents, they also are advised to follow infection prevention protocol of COVID-19. So that is what is there and what additional role NRC staffs they are doing. They sensitize mother and caregiver on essential nutrition practices during this COVID-19. They sensitize mother on follow-up schedule, services available at the community level regarding THR, ensuring ability of soap, sanitizer at the NRC. And then additional these cleanliness and social distancing that we have to follow for COVID. So this is what we changes we have. So this is all regarding this managing NRC during COVID.
Thank you, Dr. Naveen. Praveen, it was really nice to hear what are the, basically we had a idea that how it would have been running during this COVID, these programs. So it was really nice to understand what are the precautions that government and all other hospitals are taking care of in the sector to implement the scheme. I would now request Dr. Ash Alka Yadavji, Professor of Pediatrics. He is the in charge of NRRTC and she'll be presenting a case study on management of SAM at in-facility level. Over to you, ma'am. Dr. Alka, you need to give your views. You are muted, ma'am.
Am I audible now?
Yes, you are.
Can I, is my screen visible?
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
Please go ahead, ma'am.
Probably my lecture is going to be a longer lecture because on case-to-case basis, how we are managing the children in the community or severe acute malnutrition. Okay, I have what we are doing, our practices. I'll be sharing the experiences with you. Thanks for the organizers for giving me the opportunity to do so. Okay. So I'm sure all of us, we know good nutrition allows children to survive, develop and learn, play and participate. But all this is stolen if the child is really malnourished. These pictures, you can really understand. This child is at present admitted in our NRC. This is to look for edema. I think this crowd does not need the introduction of this sort. Why we are worried about SAM is increase in the mortality. Overall mortality was 25.8% with the split up of mortality in various conditions which has been given. Up to 18 months, by and large, it is related to the dehydration and pneumonia. But beyond 18 months, predominantly the mortality cause analysis was pneumonia. Okay, the definition of severe acute malnutrition is in younger children. But here I want to sensitize that beyond 5 years, we call these children on the basis of body mass index as children severe thinness. That is also a reason to worry. This is the malnutrition at various ages. This is severe thin child. This is infantile malnutrition. This is edematous malnutrition. These are the terminologies. Actually, I feel underweight is one aspect, wasting, stunting. Wasting is actually acute malnutrition and stunting is chronic malnutrition. So what we want to focus is mainly the nutrition focused physical examination for diagnosis of malnutrition. It is not a rocket science. All our ASHA workers and Anganwadi workers can be trained with for nutrition focused physical examination. This includes a detailed anthropometry with interpretation. You have to look for features of micronutrient deficiencies. You look for signs of underlying complications and infections. And you have to do what is most important is an appetite test. Believe me, there is no laboratory marker. Like if you get infection, your CRP is positive, your total cells are elevated. But there is no laboratory marker which will diagnose malnutrition. So this has to be really corrected with the help, or this has to be taught with the help of Anganwadi workers. This is how we identify edema and look at the edema. It's milder if it is plus one, moderate if it is below the up to the thighs and hands, and gross if it is all over. See, this is how we have to measure with the MUAC tape. I'm not going into the details of measuring into the MUAC tape, but you have to have two fixed points. One is a tip of the shoulder, that is tip of the acromion process, tip of the olecranon process, the midpoint between the two. And conventionally, it is done with the left forearm. Then we have to go for weighing the child. You know, electronic weighing scale is preferable. You have to do it with the help of the mother and plot it on the chart. What is the concept called? We have to popularize the concept. If the child between 1 to 2 years who is unable to stand on the weighing scale, we need to do a double weighing where mother and child pair are weighed together, and then the mother is removed, a child is taken by the attendant and the mother is weighed. The same way we need to take the length with the help of infantometer and height with the help of stadiometer with the fixed points which are there. All this, we have a WHO growth charts, which are WHO 2000, devised in 2006. In between, you have a median with -2 and -3 standard deviation. Anything less than -3 standard deviation is considered as severe. Weight for length less than -3 is considered as severe acute malnutrition. So you really have to consider or showing them these charts. The same thing which we can plot in a pictorial way in the graph. So either Anganwadi workers, they can plot this and give it to the mother. And actually for actual ready references, they can go to the numerical values. So every Anganwadi worker or every person who's dealing with severe acute malnutrition should be well versed with red flag signs for severe acute malnutrition. And what are the red flag signs? One, age less than 1 year. If the child has bilateral pedal edema more than plus one, but in our all practical purposes, we say that any child who's edematous should be referred to NRRTC and should be admitted. Child who has failed in appetite test, it's a very serious condition and this child needs admission, assessment, evaluation. A child who has relapsed, who has already SAM, went back into the community and has come back again with SAM. This child needs a close monitoring and evaluation. Plus the common complications which any SAM child faces. Hypoglycemia, hypothermia, electrolyte imbalances, presence of infection, sepsis, associated underlying conditions like HIV, tuberculosis, malignancy, or any child with any of these red flag signs definitely need an inpatient care, cannot be admitted into the community, cannot be managed at a community level. What is more important is giving the emphasis on the appetite test. So to reduce the mortality and morbidity, it is required that we have to have an early identification of children with severe acute malnutrition they are triaged whether they can be managed at the facility-based care or a community-based care. In my opinion, we cannot have a fixed differentiation between a facility and a community-based care. Both these things have to go hand in hand. Both these facility as well as community-based care are interlinked. So the treatment approach in the facility-based care goes in four phases. First is a stabilization phase where we start with the cautious feeding beginning with F75. Then comes a transition phase which once the child shows signs of improvement, then the child is shifted from F75 to F100 feeds. Then we subject the child to an appetite test, and once he passes appetite test, child goes into the rehabilitation phase with preferred food as ready to use therapeutic food, which could be indigenously prepared, which may be centrally prepared, or which may be locally prepared. So why do an appetite test? More important, because if the child loss of appetite is a very, very serious sign, there is definitely a problem in the milieu of the child which leads to a loss of appetite. And when the child has loss of appetite, child is at immediate risk of death. So we must do an appetite test. So this is appetite test, in my opinion, is the key determinant to decide whether he needs NRC or he can be managed at outpatient treatment center. So that's the reason why I'm insisting it again. So how do we do appetite test? It is done in a quiet area with the dietitian, where child is not fed for 1 or 2 hours, and then the child comes and he has been offered either a RUTF or whatever food he wants to eat, he should be given. So we do it with RUTF, we call it as medical nutrition therapy, and this is the appetite test lookup chart. Depending on the weight band of the child, we give them a maximum amount of RUTF or MNT to eat. And if the child, we look at it, if the child passes appetite test, means if he is moderate or good, we take it as child passing appetite test. Okay, so once the child's appetite test is performed, we decide how do we go about. If the child pass appetite test, we have screened, looked at him, he has no complication, then obviously he goes directly into the rehabilitation phase of treatment with NRC, either with F100 or a mixed feeding on demand. But if the child fails appetite test, obviously the child goes into an initial stabilization phase.
Yeah, Dr. Alka, just to remind you, only 5 minutes to you. Kindly wind up because we have other speakers also.
Yes. So accordingly, so child goes into the transition phase, and from transition phase he goes into the rehabilitation phase. Okay. So these are the list of phases. Phase one uses therapeutic milk of F75, which gives 75 kilocalories and 1 gram of protein per 100 ml of food. We start initially with F75 as per the F75 lookup chart, and usually we prefer to feed them every 2 hourly. Once the child is monitored, child is good, we feel child is improving clinically, from phase one, he goes into a transition phase. In the transition phase, we use the therapeutic milk, which is F100, okay? So this F100 gives 100 kilocalories and 3 grams of proteins. So once he tolerates F100 well, the edema starts resolving, child starts feeling symptomatically better, then obviously we go to the child, we perform the appetite test, and with good appetite test, edema resolving, child goes into RUTF. Okay, so this is the mixed feeding followed by MNT or RUTF, what we will be doing. And we monitor the child for weight gain when he is on RUTF. A weight gain of 5 to 10 grams per kg is considered as moderate, and more than 10 is considered as good weight gain. So when in the rehabilitation phase, we have two options, when RUTF is available and when RUTF is not available. Okay. So CMAM is another way of managing. CMAM along with facility-based care is the integrated way of managing children with severe acute malnutrition. We have treatment option available. One is centrally prepared RUTF, indigenously prepared RUTF, then the locally prepared RUTF, augmented home prepared food. We have locally prepared amylase-rich food and traditional standard nutrition therapy. So these are the F75. We have a production unit at NRRTC Sion Hospital where we prepare this RUTF indigenously in the cup as well as sachet form. It is made out of soybean oil, peanut paste, sugar, skim milk powder, along with micronutrient in the form WHO approved. It is made up with a simple machine in a small room. Okay, So this is about comparison. So RUTF is the treatment of choice and we have the clinical monitoring unit. This is how we do. We admit the child, do the anthropometry examination. We do finish with the counseling, appetite test and follow up. These are our success stories. These are the examples of amylase rich powder when we show them on cooking demonstration. This amylase rich powder can be added to the upma premix. These are the various our cooking demonstration recipes with the chart which we are giving to the children coming from Anganwadis. So once we discharge them, we follow them up telephonically. And now we have a telemedicine facility available. So we prepare and follow them up with the help of telemedicine. This is my dedicated team with under the leadership of Dr. Radha Gildial, Dr. Prachi Karni, myself, and our medical officer, Dr. Annapurna, and one of my assistant professor, Dr. Yash and Prachi. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, ma'am, for sharing. No problem, ma'am. We thank you very much for sharing the technical aspects of preparing the diet and monitoring the kids, child right from the beginning and sharing the different phases of SAM. I would now request Ms. Gulati, Deepthi Gulati, to share her views in on the case study on management of SAM at community level. Over to you, ma'am. You are muted.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, we can.
And I would like to share my screen. And can you see the screen?
Yes, ma'am, we can.
Okay. Just a moment. Friends, I just want to say that I'm so delighted that I'm here to be talking about, I think my screen is gone again, my presentation.
We can see your presentation.
And we can see.
Okay, because I can't see my presentation and so I was getting a little confused.
मैम आपने उसे मिनिमाइज कर दिया
सर प्रॉब्लम कुछ हो रही है एंड कैन वी हैव द नेक्स्ट स्पीकर एंड आई विल गेट बैक इन अ मिनट
या श्योर मैम आई विल नाउ रिक्वेस्ट डॉक्टर प्रवीण टू शेयर द रिकमेंडेशंस एंड वे फॉरवर्ड
ओ
Can you share?
Yeah. Can you see the screen now? Can you see the screen?
No, ma'am, we cannot.
I'm not able to, ma'am. Anoop, can you help Dr. Deepthi? Yes, now it is visible, Deepthi, ma'am.
but it has to be visible to me too.
Ma'am, I'm Dr. Praveen. If you minimize from the top button, then your presentation will be visible to you. If you go on top, there is one minimize.
Yes, I'm trying that. I'm trying that. That is not working. I don't know. So you go ahead with the and then mine is only a case study, which I can share a little later if you don't mind.
So would request Dr. Praveen, you can share the recommendations and way forward. In the meantime, let Ms. Deepti be ready with that.
Sure. Thank you so much.
Okay. So thank you very much, Nirupma. What are the key? No, I do not have any presentation for this session. So I will be just speaking only what I could gather from all the presentation which were made. We all do agree that prevalence of severe acute malnutrition is unacceptably high in India, as it was shown, 7.5% of our under 5 children, they are severely acute malnourished as per National Family Health Survey 4 data. And even CNNS is showing 4.9%, which is quite high if you go by global guidelines. Then also, Ranadeep, he has highlighted that there are modeling to suggest that the wasting and severe wasting is likely to increase because of the COVID, which is there. And there is all possibility that there may be increase in severe wasting because of the COVID. This was mentioned that for tackling severe acute malnutrition, we need integrated management of severe acute malnutrition. And where you have prevention at the center stage, and you should have measures of prevention. But at the same time, the children who have become severely acute malnourished, they need therapeutic management. And that you have two forms, as has been highlighted. 85 to 90% of the children, they may be managed in community-based management if you have that in place. While 10 to 15% of the children, they need facility-based management. So already highlighted, this is delayed community-based management, and because of the several, because we have lack of consensus on the food item to be used. But then whatever food item we select, these food items should be safe, palatable, and then also this should be able to meet requirement of a SAM child in terms of energy, in terms of protein, in terms of micronutrients. So whatever food item we are selecting, we will have to make it suitable for requirement of a SAM child by whatever combination we are making. We do understand that CSAM is not synonym with a particular food item, which is being seen. CSAM has several steps. You write from identification in the community, doing examining them for medical complication. Then you have nutritional management, you have certain medical management, you have health education, you have counseling, you also teach them. So CSAM is a program where you have different components. This should not be seen as synonym with a food item or whatever food item we say. So there is a whole measures of services which is there in the CSAM. And if you have these active screening going on, you will be able to identify them and to prevent the risk of mortality or risk of overall brain development and other development delays are there. So we are hopeful that we will have CMAM guideline very soon, and that is what we expect. And probably with the release of the CSAM program, and CMAM guideline, we of us know, we have facility-based management guideline in since 2011, and we have more than 1,000 nutritional rehabilitation centers across the country. But at the same time, we know that alone will not be able to take care of severe acute malnourished children, which we have in this country. So we need the CMM program. I don't have any doubt about this. But at the same time, we will have to reach consensus. We need this guideline so that the larger, this may be expanded to all the children who need this management. With these words, I think I will stop here. This is the summary what I could gather from all the presentation.
Okay, Dr. Praveen, in fact, we would also like to have this in writing as well so that SOCHAM can be of use to push it. And from our organizational level, we'll also try to recommend this in our policy advocacy to the government. So are we ready now, Dipti ma'am? You're muted.
I think I am. And I'll So I'll just go to my screen and see. Otherwise, I'll request your IT to do it. Okay.
Sure.
Can you see the screen now? Can you see the screen?
Yes, we can.
Hello, Kima. Can you see my slide?
Yes.
You can see the slides, no? Okay. So we'll start with the project that we had. It was called Poshan Project. Again, the slides have gone. I don't know how. It's very unfortunate that it is the second time it's happening again. Yes. So can you see the slides now?
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
Yes, ma'am.
So this was a Poshan project which was implemented by the National Health Mission, Government of Rajasthan, and it was supported by GAIN, UNICEF, ACF, and Tata Trust. And I'm very happy to share that Mr. Naveen Jain led it by from front and gave us all the support that was required. When we talk of Project Poshan, I'll share with you the intervention districts that we had. We had 13 intervention districts and 41 blocks in the phase one. And then we had another 20 districts and 45 blocks in the phase two. And we covered almost 45 blocks in the second phase and 41 blocks in the third phase. 41 blocks in the first phase. It doesn't seem to be moving. The approach that we followed.
Ma'am, we are doing your PPT, ma'am. Okay.
Okay. Okay. Thank you. We followed a life cycle approach. The focus was on critical periods of nutritional vulnerability and opportunity for enhancing human development potential. Our emphasis was on preventing undernutrition. Next. And we also focused on ensuring social inclusion of the marginalized community groups. And our effort was to reach the most vulnerable and the deprived. And we happened to reach them. Our emphasis was also on enhancing the skills and development pathways and to motivate both the frontline workers and the mothers, because they are the prime movers for the social change. We strengthened the ownership of this project by bringing in the Panchayati Raj institutions, and we brought about convergence between ICDS and NHM at all levels. It helped to enable the families and the communities to improve the caretaking behavior and nutrition of children and women. We encouraged them to demand quality services and contribute to the increased service utilization, because many a times it happens that we have the services, people don't come forward. So we wanted them to even enhance the service utilization. The process was first selection of districts and blocks, which I shared. We covered 41 blocks in phase one, 45 blocks in phase two. Then the second step was screening and identification, enrollment, treatment phase, which lasted between 8 to 12 weeks, and a follow-up phase, which lasted for 16 weeks. Next, please. The project components included project management, which comprised establishment of project management unit for planning, supervision, monitoring, and providing technical support to the government. This was embedded within the NHM and GAIN supported it. Then we had the technical support and project oversight, for which we set up a technical advisory committee and a product approval committee. I want to emphasize that this was very, very important, both to get advice on how to move forward from the technical advisory committee and a product. As Naveen Jain sir had already mentioned, there was a lot of criticism of EDNS, RUTF. So we wanted that there should be a committee that should approve the product that we are using and certify that, yes, it is good for the people. So these two committees were formed and the procurement was done in the most transparent manner. Then we also did the sensitization of district health officials. This was followed by procurement of anthropometric equipment through a tendering process so that it was very transparent. Next, please. Next, please. Next. Next. So it comprised the logistics regarding procurement of anthropometric equipment, procurement of energy dense supplementation, sensitization and training building, training and capacity building of the frontline workers, which was very critical for delivery of the program on ground. Next, please. So the framework for implementation comprised selection of districts, screening, and we screened with MUAC. And as sir has mentioned, we did talk about providing MUAC to mothers at home. But you also know that in between there was a phase when Ministry of Women and Child Development, Government of India, had said that we would not be using MUAC. And I'm so happy that they are again suggesting that MUAC should be used for screening purposes. So there is a difference between screening, identification. So screening is that you use a MUAC and you screen children, and identification is when you take the weight and height of children to identify whether they are actually suffering from SAM or not. Then of course there was an enrollment. So those who were identified as SAM children were examined by the ANMs and block chief medical officers. Those with infections, spitting edema and poor appetite were referred to the malnutrition treatment centers, and the others were enrolled for CMAM and treated at home. So the treatment phase actually lasted from 8 to 13 weeks. Each enrolled child was given the medical nutrition therapy kit, which comprised deworming tablets, antibiotics, energy dense nutrition supplements for 8 to 10 weeks. And I'm very happy to share that the protocols that we followed were exactly the way Indian Academy of Pediatrics has recommended in its consensus statement of 2011, which has not been withdrawn till date. So we did not violate any one single norm of managing SAM at home through the community-based approach. So this is something that I want to tell everyone very clearly, that we followed IAP guidelines, which are in line with WHO and UNICEF also. Then there was a weekly review of all children at the sub-center for providing the EDNS. And then as and when they graduated to good health, they were discharged as per the protocols. In the follow-up phase, we were getting the child visited by a health worker, Poshan Prahari, every day till the child was was considered as healthy and out of the program. And it was then followed up for 2 to 4 weeks for visit every 2 to 4 weeks for 4 months. Mothers were counseled on caring, and each child was followed up at the health sub-center every month. So we took care to see that the child really was well entrenched into good health. Next, please. The key highlights of this Poshan project are that it was based on the principles of DOTS. Again, this was a brainchild of Mr. Naveen Jain, that he said that when tuberculosis was overcome, DOTS technology was used, or DOTS strategy was used. And this was recommended for tuberculosis by WHO. So we also use the same approach. So the And most important was that there was a very high government commitment, including political will at all levels. It was publicly stated by the Honorable Chief Minister of Rajasthan that we are very happy with the CMAM program, how it is planned and how it is progressing. Stakeholders' commitment and engagement was ensured by signing an MOU. So all the partners signed an MOU with the government so that it brought in their own commitment from the organization as well as on ground. Then there was, of course, case detection through screening of children using MUAC, and management of SAM was based on IAP, WHO, UNICEF guidelines and protocols, which we have shared earlier. Next, please. There was a perfect supply chain that was maintained to ensure that there was no stock out of EDNS at any block or health subcenter. This was one of our biggest success, thanks to all the suppliers and also the government machinery, which came on board so willingly and so strongly. There was a daily case follow-up by Asha at home and direct weekly monitoring by A&M at the health subcenter for the next 4 months on a weekly or monthly basis. Each child's recovery from SAM and progress was tracked individually using a Journey to Health booklet, which again has been mentioned by Mr. Jain, that we put a picture of the child, how it was in the beginning and how that child looked at the end of the program. So management information system was also developed for standardized recording and reporting and to take corrective action immediately. There was a multi-stakeholder technical advisory committee, and the best part is that no new cadre was created, because if you create a new cadre, replication of such a program becomes very difficult. So there was no new cadre created. Only the A&Ms and ASHAs were incentivized to deliver results on ground. Next, please. As you can see, in the first phase, 9,640 children were enrolled, and in the second phase, 10,344 children were enrolled. And there was a good combination of boys and girls. As you can see, in both phases, 45% to 46% boys were enrolled and 55% to 54% of girls were enrolled. Next, please. Next, please. Yeah. If we see the gender-wise distribution of children, what we found was that 44% of overall, 44% boys and 56% girls were enrolled. If we look at the malnutrition in the first 24 months, or between 6 months to 24 months, 71% of the entire children, SAM children, were in this age group, that is 6 to 24 months. And that is exactly what we have been talking about, the importance of 1,000 days, first 1,000 days, importance of focusing in the early infancy. And what you would see here is 30% of boys and 41% of girls were suffering from SAM. And in the age group of 25 to 59 months, the SAM percentage was only 29%. Next, please. So when we talk of our success, the average weight gain from the time enrolled, from the time that children were enrolled to that at 4 weeks, 8 weeks or 13 weeks was between 5 to 6 grams per kg per day. It is less than what was gained at MTC or NRC, but it is physiologically good, and continuous weight gain over a longer period of time at a steady pace without dislocation always helps the child to recover. So this pace of weight gain is very similar to that is reported across the world. Very few children recovered in under 4 weeks. About 71 to 88% children recovered from SAM between 8 to 12 weeks of our sustained interventions. This recovery rate, we are very happy and proud to say, is better than the global yardstick. Credit is all due to the NHM for recovery and follow-up and to ICDS for rehabilitation of children and looking after them and following it up with them once they were declared as not being SAM. Next. As you would see, this is the data from our phase one and phase two. In phase one, our recovery rate was 88%. In phase two, the recovery rate was 71%. You may be wondering why there is a lower recovery rate in phase two when we had all the experience. Here, I would like to share with you, we had purposely spaced out phase one and phase two. In phase one, we had the children, we implemented the program in November, December, January. These are the months when there is a lot of food available in the house. Mothers normally give a lot of ghee to the children considering thand ka mausam, it's cold season. And then we thought that let us see if our program also works in a time frame when children normally fall sick, which is May, June, July. These are the rainy season and there is an onset of diarrhea. We are very happy to share that this is the time, even in this phase, we had a very high recovery rate of 71%. As you would see in this slide, there was a very high defaulter rate of 11%. This was due to the migration of people from Rajasthan to the nearby states in, to look out for the jobs. So we were not able to get the children in the centers for giving the entire treatment for the entire duration. Yet the recovery rate is commendably high, 71%. Next, please. So just to wind up and say why it worked, there was bureaucratic wisdom to adopt DOT strategy. There was very strong commitment and very strong partnership. There was effective management focusing on transparency and efficiency. These were the two key words that drove NHM as well as all the four development partners. We also had an independent validation carried out by persons outside the program covering 10% of the total enrolled children after 4 months of follow-up. It showed that a vast majority of children who had recovered did not slip back. And this was vindication of the commitment with which the program was implemented and the mothers counseled to take better care of their children. So we can just perhaps attribute the active engagement with the community, quality follow-up by the ANMs, Anganwadi workers and ASHAs, and also the ANMs ASHAs were also called the Poshan Praharis. Next, please. Here I would like to show you that how our children progressed from day one till the time they were discharged. You can, in one picture, as you can see, you can count the ribs. And the same child, you have cheeks hanging out in just about 11 weeks of time. And that was very, very motivating and very satisfying for all of us. In the second picture also, you can see a child which is skin and bone. And the same child is so healthy and the mother is so happy. So our teams have done us a lot of proud in helping these children progress in their journey towards survival and growth. Next, a few pictures only and I'm winding up. So here we have children saying that we are back to good health. Next. Next, please. As you can see, these are the children who have recovered and they would remain healthy. So together they have overcome. And next. And they are the winners. This was a very rejoicing moment for all of us. When all the mothers had come, we had with their children, we gifted them, to say that you are the winners. And they felt very happy. Our teams felt very happy and proud, the NHM teams. So thank you so much for giving me this opportunity to share with you a project that is closest to my heart. I've been working on food fortification for 20 years. In this project, I worked for only about 3 to 3.5 years, but this remains my most beautiful project. Thank you.
Thank you very much, ma'am. Thank you very much for sharing such a nice experience and in fact making a change in the lives of the people. Since we come to the conclusion of the webinar, the very first question I would like to ask you only, because you were the last speaker, what are the biggest challenge that you face? What are the biggest challenge that you feel can be faced if the simulation is done in other states?
I don't think there are any challenges now, because everyone now understands the need and importance of SAM management, and more so at the community level. The challenge will come only, the challenge is because we have not yet got the clearance or a clear-cut policy from the government on EDNS RUTF. I wish the government would give this a top priority. There is a National Nutrition Technical Board, and it is this board that has to review and give the recommendation. So it would be my urgent and ardent request to NNTB to please take this up and advise. Because to me, if you honestly ask, it only required getting all together and getting all committed. And this was, we got them together, and believe it or not, whether it was ANMs, whether it was LHVs, whether it was ASHAs or the Anganwadi workers, everyone joined with a lot of enthusiasm. So if we sensitize the bureaucracy, if we sensitize WCD and NHM, and everyone says that NHM and ICDS are two sides of the same coin. When you say two sides of the same coin, each side does not see the other side. So here I would say, let's not call them the sides of the same coin, because if they remain sides of the same coin, they will never see eye to eye. So we say that they are hands that fold together. And when they fold together, they deliver on ground. And this is, has been our experience. The children were rehabilitated through this CMAM approach by NHM. But if ICDS had not done their job, if ICDS had not followed it, followed up with them at the Anganwadi center level, relapse would have been very high. So hats off to ICDS team also, which pitched in their best. So it all depends how you sensitize, how you bring the partners together, get their commitment, and then it is smooth sailing, because everyone is here to do their job and do it with conviction.
So that means it's a collaborative approach. Both the government, absolutely, both the departments have to collaborate and work together. Nice.
Yes, and now, they did it beautifully.
Yes, yes, truly, I can see the change. Wonderful. And in fact, I would also like to hear from you in writing or something, some document which SHM can also pursue at our level to sensitize, sure, both the departments at the central level. Now, I'd like to know what are the technical regulations that, you know, monitor the diets. That question goes to Dr. Ranadeep. Dr. Ranadeep, are you here? I think he's left. Okay. Would Dr. Praveen like to answer it? How do we monitor? What are the technical regulations that regulates the diet of RUTF?
So at this point of time, we do not have any central government guide on this. So this is what you do not have any, you do not have any guidance from central government. So whatever is being used, this was being used as a pilot, or the states, they have used this to take care of nutrition of these children. And whatever regulation, if you are, we talk, then FSSAI is the regulatory body which we feel. It's open to comment by other panelists if they have to suggest any other point.
Would you like to comment on that?
You're asking me?
No, Dr. Ranadeep.
Okay, sorry.
Yes, please go ahead.
I was muted by the organizer. It was written that I was muted by the organizer.
Okay. Yeah. I apologize.
So can you repeat that question again? Sorry.
Yeah, my question was basically, what are the technical regulations that monitors the quality of the diet that is being used in RUTF?
The RUTF itself, it goes through rigorous quality process for any RUTF manufacturer, whatever it is, in India or outside India. In India, there are few companies that are producing RUTF. Those all go through all the protocols, all the quality checks by the FSSAI. But the issue is not about the quality of the RUTF. Nobody has raised the questions of the quality of RUTF or even for the quality of the RUSF. The issue is that whether RUTF could be used as a part of community-based management of SAM. And that's right, the right. debate we are having for last few years.
To that question, still many people have reservation, especially at state level, whether to approve the, you know, usage of these diets for managing SAM or, I mean, why they have such reservations? That's my next question. If Deepti ma'am would like to answer it.
Okay.
No, I think Ranadeep is best positioned to talk about it because both Madam Neeta Bhandari and earlier Dr. Bhan, they were on NNTV. So he can talk and then maybe I can add.
Over to you, Dr. Ranadeep.
We need to understand one issue. It's my totally personal opinion. One issue is the prevention that also Dr. Praveen mentioned, prevention of severe acute malnutrition. And the second issue is the management. Nobody is raising question about the prevention part. For the prevention, you need to have a diverse complementary feeding for 6 to 59 months of age to prevent and other aspects. But for the management part, you need to see this SAM as a disease entity. So suppose if somebody has any other disease X, what would be the management? Management would be give some medicine to cure that disease and thereafter take for other precautions so that it should not happen in future. Now take this example for SAM. SAM is a disease condition. There should be some management for that, management X. After that management X, if the child gets cured, then the child would be put on the preventive aspect so that in future, the child should not relapse or should not falter. So if we follow this principle, then whether it is a ready-to-use therapeutic food, whether we call it as an energy dense supplementary food, that's different issue.
So I want to understand what is the hindrance that, you know, that prevents many of the governments or, you know, bureaucratic people to allow it to be administered.
I think this is a controversial thing we are going, and I think Dr. Deepti Gulati would be the best person to answer this.
Because one who has convinced the comment on that. Yes, thank you.
I'm known to be very blunt. And what I'm saying is certainly purely Deepti Gulati's own perception. And it is not, I'm not speaking on behalf of any organization. While we were implementing this program, we have come across, some criticism. Some people who are saying that you are giving something which is industry produced and why not give food which is there at home? My question is the same thing. That if a person is suffering from high blood pressure, you first give them medicines and you try to control the blood pressure. Same is the case with diabetes. You give medicines or you give something that controls. Once they are in control, then you say, okay, now you are in control. Continue with precautions and continue having your proper diet and everything from home. So same is the case. Severe acute malnutrition is not a disease, but it is the presentation of perhaps disease and poor feeding habits or reasons why mothers have not been able to feed their children. I have worked in the field and have found that many a times when we used to tell the mothers, aap isko khilate kyun nahi ho? So they would say, dant to abhi aaye nahi. So if you don't have teeth, you are not able to feed the child. So we say, okay, dant sirf chew karne ka kaam karte hai, peesne ka kaam karte hai. Give the child mashed food, the rest would happen inside. So you have to counsel the mothers, and when you counsel the mothers, they do take care of it. We also tell them, put a lot of sugar and some bit of ghee into it, like we make churma and all, and give it to your child because your child needs extra energy. So what they feel is, oh, if we put some ghee or we put some fat, maybe the child would have some diarrhea. So these are the kind of things that mothers have in their perception, in their mind. And these are the things which can lead to, slowly have the onset of, losing weight, undernutrition, MAM and then SAM. And one episode of diarrhea or one episode of any illness would push them into SAM or severe SAM. Now, when we are talking about CMAM, it is an approach to rehabilitate the child. We are not saying that give this EDNS sachet all through the life. So another very funny thing that we come across, that they say that, oh, the calories in EDNS has come, a lot of calories in EDNS are coming from fat. Now, 92 grams of sachet gives 500 calories. About 50% of the composition is made with, or 50% of the calories may be coming from fat. So if we say 50% of the calories, 50% of 500 is just about 250 calories. So when you talk of the oil content, it is very minimal. It is very, very minimal. As it is, the average consumption of oil should be between 25 to 30 grams to absorb the fat-soluble vitamins. So there are myths and misconceptions. And one thing that we must feel very happy and confident about, and also tell the government anywhere they are sitting, that EDNS or RUTF, whatever name you may call, Poshan Amrit or whatever, this is exactly as per the guidelines of Indian Academy of Pediatrics, which is the highest body advising the country and the policy makers on different aspects of pediatric care. If there is a consensus statement that has been issued by Indian Academy of Pediatrics, signed by over 400 people, and it says that CMAM is a good thing, this is how it should be implemented, and I can only tell you about Rajasthan. CMAM in Rajasthan was implemented with full stop and comma as given in the IAP consensus statement, and the recipe or the ingredients and the proportion that were used to prepare EDNS is exactly how it was in the IAP.
So I don't see
any reason why anyone should be complaining unless and until Indian Academy of Pediatrics comes up with another consensus statement or withdraws earlier. They haven't done it. So they know that this is good, and let's go by the IAP advice and continue to do a very good job of CMAM implementation.
So that means we need to sensitize the state governments for that.
Absolutely.
Yes, Dr. Alka, you want to say something?
We have been preparing this medical nutrition therapy indigenously, and it is now we have completed 9 years. We have successfully treated 5,000 children.
Wonderful.
The publication will be on the way. Probably we have good experience. The relapse rates are also common. But the worry of government is also not wrong, because most of the times the behavior change or the behavior modification which happens with the mother, it's temporary. Again, they go back. At least I have an experience working in urban slums of Mumbai. So most of the times the working mother, the working grandparents, so once they are off RUTF, most of the times they come back, because our relapse rate are in the tune of 25%, you know. So it's not, I'm not saying we have been using it, but the worries are also, I mean, there are two sides of the coins, you know, but this doesn't mean that we should not be using it.
I just want to add that this is where the role of ICDS becomes very prominent, because ICDS needs to tell the mothers that give the child a wholesome diet, and in each, and they also have to tell the mothers that you have to add little bit of ghee, oil, what butter, whatever they may want in every meal of the child, because child needs half of the energy as an adult. Where would the child get that energy if the child was only taking cereals? So you need to have some bit of, you need to have adequate protein as well as oil, ghee, butter in the diet of the child. Otherwise the child is going to suffer from SAM. And very often you come across even the educated ones, they say, oh, ghee tel bacche ko khila de, abhi se usko heart patient bana de, abhi se uske cholesterol bada de. So we need to focus on education of the mother through the pediatricians, through the Anganwadi workers, through all the health workers, and through people like you and me, who would bring it to the notice of the mother that the child needs a wholesome food, and oil, ghee are also part of it. I'm not saying ki kab bhar ke tel piyo, but don't think that, don't add. Yeah.
Right. Thank you. Thank you very much. I think we now come closer to the conclusion, and I would now request Mr. Tarun Vaj, which is the country director again, to give his concluding remarks. Tarun sir.
Many thanks, ma'am, for inviting me to the webinar. I've been listening for about 1 hour. I'm sorry I couldn't join at the beginning. This is a subject, as my colleague Deepti mentioned, very close to Gaines' heart. We very, very diligently did our program in Rajasthan. The hope was that the debate around EDNS, RUTF, appropriate food, whatever terminology we want to use in the country, arrives at a consensus so that we don't let our children wait anymore. We are cognizant of the fact that severe acute malnutrition or moderate malnutrition all require a multi-sectoral response. We need to integrate services at the district level, sanitation, behavior change, you know, good monitoring, proper immunization, diarrhea management, so many things get involved. Having said that, we only say that, you know, India's children should not be made to wait till all of us are debating. Our children need appropriate prevention and appropriate treatment both. And I think between the excellent national technical experts that one has listened to in today's webinar, and the wisdom of our bureaucracy, I worked very closely with Naveenji, you know, earlier, and we have excellent organizations, you know, Hexagon, Compact, there are so many who are ready and waiting. And I think in several public health interventions, nutrition interventions, we have shown as a country that once we get after solving something, we are very perfectly equipped, whether it is large companies, small scale sector, state level ICDS, midday meal, PDS, ASSOCHAM, FICCI, everybody, all of us are perfectly equipped to trust each other, perfectly equipped to build partnerships and to take solutions to scale. So I think I love the way Dr. Praveen was saying that this condition in the country is unacceptable. Integrated management is needed, including prevention and treatment. This lack of consensus on which is the appropriate food must be resolved through whichever of us is more effective in communicating this to the policymakers, and the CMAM guidelines should be out and be circulated at the state level, district level, and understood by practitioners at yes. the very soonest. So, madam, my sincere submission once again is we owe this to India's children, to our next generation. We should not make them wait much more. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, sir. In fact, ASSOCHAM is also privileged to be associated with this webinar. I would like to thank all the dignitaries, all the panelists today, and would like to thank Hexagon Nutrition for sponsoring us. Thank you very much, sir. We thank you very much, Vikram sir, for supporting us and taking this course across the, you know, across the year. We have been doing it with Hexagon Nutrition, and we are sure we'll be coming up with such initiatives as and when possible. Thank you very much. Thank you everyone for joining. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you.